going, everyone? This is Carl at APSX. Welcome back. And today, the intention of our video is for prospect customers and current customers who recently purchased our PIM. We've been getting a lot of questions lately. So let's get started. We wanted to first do a troubleshooting guide for people who are new to injection molding. We'll walk you through some of the injection parameters on the machine, and we'll show you how to make good parts. Now, for example, this here is the test mold right here and here that we machine here at APSX and test all our machines on before shipping them. And this mold comes complete with the purchase of your machine, and it comes installed on every single machine that we sell. Now, the purpose of this is to get you familiarized with molding on this in single shot mode before you actually start making more complex molds and using injector mechanisms and making your own parts, to get you familiarized with injection parameters and, you know, basically how to troubleshoot as well. We wanted to walk you through a couple different scenarios of, say, for example, flashing and incomplete parts, and why does this happen? To get started today, for the first scenario, we want to talk about an incomplete part. Now, the most common thing that would create an incomplete part is not having enough injection pressure. So you can manually control that from the tablet. And today we're going to reduce the injection pressure from around 220, which is normal for making this part, to about 100, and we're going to run the machine on less than ideal settings so that you can see what making a incomplete part looks like. Now, injection pressure is not the only thing that might create an incomplete part. You might also need to increase the fill speed on the tablet, or you would call that maybe injection speed. You could also increase the barrel temperature and mold temperature incrementally if you're getting incomplete parts. And there's also a couple other scenarios, and you can also look at our troubleshooting guide on the page 38 of our manual. Has a troubleshooting guide that will walk you through more scenarios. So right now, it looks like the machine with the injection pressure set to 100 didn't reach its desired amount for the part and made a short part. So the cycle completed, and we'll pull that out and see what it looks like. And there you go, still hot. And you can see it didn't make the complete square part, which is what it normally should make. Now I want to talk about flashing. So there's also many different scenarios that can create flashing on your part, which looks like this. You can see there's material that's coming out of the edge of the part in different areas, and usually this is an indication that your clamp force is too low, so the mold is not pushing together with enough pressure there. So let's again run this mold on a less than ideal scenario for you guys to see what that looks like. So normally for this mold, its clamp force is set to 20. I'm gonna run it on 3 so we can get a really good example of flashing for you. And some other things that might cause flashing are you need to reduce injection pressure. You might need to reduce the fill speed. Also reducing mold temperature. And lastly, you may need to check the mold alignment or repair your mold. That's an unlikely scenario. So again, in our troubleshooting guide, page 38 of our manual, you can look into these different scenarios for flashing and see in what order you should diagnose your machine and change settings. So now the machine is homing. And let's take a look at our part and see what flashing looks like. And there you have it. So as you can see on our part, the mold did not clamp all the way, and we have a little bit of excess plastic coming off. Okay. So, next thing we want to talk about today are parts sticking. And before we get into parts sticking, this is the spray that we like to use. It's just a heavy-duty mold release spray by Tough Coat. And you would just go ahead and, if your parts are sticking, you can go ahead and just do a light coating over the right side of your mold. And for us, this usually works pretty well, and then the parts will release over and over again. It's not a problem. But there's also a couple other scenarios for parts sticking to the right side of the mold. You might want to reduce injection pressure. And another thing you might want to try is increasing the holding time and also increasing the cooling time. So depending on the plastic that you're using, your plastic might need to sit in the mold just a little bit longer after injection before removing it from the mold. And that can help out as well. First thing we're going to talk about is different materials. What can you use? So our machine is very versatile. We can use even harder plastics such as Durlin. And this one, I believe, is nylon. And here we have a test part made out of ABS. And with some of these harder plastics, they will sometimes require drying and more careful ventilation because of more toxic fumes. For ventilation, this right here is our ventilation system. It's by Century Air Systems, and there's a link for the one that we use on our website, or you could make your own or go through someone else. Let's see here. So the most user-friendly plastics we found for our machine would be PP and PE, and this is what we here at APSX make most of our parts out of. For example, here is a magnet holder for the clamp sensor. And here is a acme nut, which we actually use now on our CNC machine for linear motion. Another thing we want to talk to you about is maximum part size. So like, what is this machine capable of? What's the biggest thing you can make? And typically, we like to tell people around 35 grams, which is what this chain cover is that we use on our plastic injection machine. And this is, you know, slightly larger than the palm of my hand. So another really good question here that we get asked a lot is colorants. Can you use different color plastics? And obviously the answer is yes, you can. And we wanted to give you guys an example here. This is a clear color, natural PP. And This right here is a yellow colorant that you would use for it. And depending on the volume that you're using, you would just mix in around 5% of the colorant, like so. Mix it together nicely so that it's in there. And you know, you can weigh these and mix it in a different tub or however you want to do it. And that should give you a nice yellow part. And in fact, I'll show you an example of one. This is a custom part that we made for somebody. Right here. Very nice. A4 piece. You know, when you want to purge plastic, this is for changing colors. So you can actually, if you're changing colors, you can actually manually use the controls on the machine and push out the old plastic before you would add in new. So you can hit injection pressure. You know, first heat the machine, open the valve so that the plastic can flow out, and then manually press injection pressure. You can push that plastic out, and then you can add more clear PP into the hopper, and then run the hopper again, push more clear PP out until you don't see any more color. Then you can, at that point, then you can mix your new batch, add new color. You might have to purge a couple times, so maybe like 3 to 4 times is usually the amount of times you would need to hit injection pressure and then home injection before all of the plastic comes out. Next thing would be for our European customer base, and this question involves power and can we use 220? And the answer is yes. You can get a transformer, or they might call it a step down power converter, that will go from 220 volts to 110 volts. So that you can just plug our regular power cord in and use our machine. And another good question is maintenance requirements. So we're actually very happy to be able to say our machine is very user friendly, has almost no learning curve to learn how to use our tablet and the injection parameters, and has very minimal amounts of maintenance that anybody can do. The first thing would be the spring and the clamp assembly have bushings that slide on these metal shafts back and forth when you're injecting and clamping plastic. And you can just use a regular synthetic motor oil, like a 10W30, once every 500 hours or so. You can lubricate these shafts so that the clamp assembly and the injection spring assembly slide easier. That's a very simple thing to do. It takes a couple minutes. And finally, you can just, there's two chains that run the spring and the clamp motor. And you can just use a generic chain oil for these. And again, maybe once every 500 hours. Okay, thanks everyone so much for watching. This concludes our video for today. I hope this gives you a little bit better idea of how to assess and troubleshoot on your machine and some of the manual controls on the machine. And we really appreciate all your views. Feel free to like and subscribe in the comment and even comment in the comment section below. And if you like our machine, go to APSX.com and purchase a machine. In fact, this one right here is for sale. So thanks again. Have a great day.